Good evening. Thank you all for coming. Welcome to the Santa Fe Institute Community Lecture Series, which is sponsored, as usual, by Thornburg Investment Management. My name is Luis Betancourt. I'm one of the resident faculty at the Institute. And tonight's my pleasure to introduce the speaker, Sandy Pentland, who's sitting over there. I'll speak shortly. He comes from the famous MIT Media Lab in MIT in Boston. So the Media Lab is sort of this fascinating place. It's sort of the epicenter of a lot of points of contact between interesting things, and especially between new technologies and human societies and people. And I think it's fair to say that Sandy and his lab is sort of at the epicenter of the Media Lab itself. So it's sort of the epicenter squared. So make the calculation in your mind, sort of as homework. So Sandy's research is especially topical in this area because it brings together many different traditional areas of science to create really new and interesting things. I think he describes himself as coming from computer science and machine learning originally, but a lot of his work really has to do with how individuals and groups learn, how we can learn about that from wearable technologies, things that you may be wearing right now, and new sensors, and how is it that we can understand better sort of our social collective intelligence, and how might we be able to use that to change societies? So the most fascinating aspect, I think, of really the work that Sandy does is really that he is able to bring all this in a very multidisciplinary way and give you a very multidimensional way of humans, much more so than it's usually done with people that come from technology. And so that really starts opening up a richer view that it is quantitative, it's measured by devices, but it has a certain emotional dimension of how people behave, how we relate to each other, and how out of those relationships we actually can sometimes be smarter, something that I think will come up in today's lecture. So all these technological developments that underlie the sort of change are really changing our world for better and worse. And so Sandy's very involved in understanding both the potential, the consequences, and make them work for good. And I think you'll hear a lot about that today, about the great potential of new technologies in our societies, which is in some sense blatant and inevitable, but also how is it that we navigate the pitfalls in ways that allow us to really reap the rewards without the costs. So, Sandy has many, many distinctions throughout his career. I'll just mention a couple, but I won't possibly do it justice. But he's currently, as I think you can see, the Toshiba Professor of Media Arts and Sciences at MIT. He was named one of the world's 7 most powerful data scientists by Forbes in 2011, so he has special powers. He might reveal some of those tonight, so pay attention. He's also the director of the World Economic Forum Data-Driven Development, and he works with the United Nations in light of the future human development goals. So if you've heard about these are really goals that all nations on Earth are working towards committing themselves to in terms of really changing the planet in terms of human development and our relationship with the environment. So it's very important, but all these incredible ambitious aims for who we are sort of socially as a planet really needs to be predicated on how we measure and how we understand progress. And so a lot of that will come out tonight. So finally, Sandy also has a new book. It's called Social Physics. And it's a book that talks about many of these things together. So I really strongly encourage you to have a look and read it because it is a treat. So without further ado, Sandy, please.
So thank you for coming out and the beautiful weather. If it was Boston, I'd be saying thanks for coming out in the terrible weather, but you know, you guys are luckier. Anyway, so what I'd like to talk about today is sort of new ways of understanding ourselves and our societies and the sort of things that we can do with it to make the world a better place. And I'm going to start this with a journey, a sort of fun journey that I took, I think. Let's see if we can make this thing work. Oh, maybe not. Okay, well then we're going to do it this way. So about 20 years ago, I had a race of cyborgs that worked with me. So these are students at MIT, and we outfitted them with, you know, little PCs that lived in a backpack with a motorcycle battery to power them, because that's what it took back then. They used ham radio to communicate, because you remember there was no such thing as internet. There was no wireless. There were no cell phones. And they had little displays, which, you know, you'd wear on your glasses that were like computer displays. And what this was a way to explore the future. Because at that point, in the sort of early 90s, it was clear that computers were going to get small, that there was going to be wireless everywhere, that the world was going to be changed by having computation and data everywhere all the time. And I figured, well, you know, we ought to figure out what this new world is going to be like, if, you know, because it's coming down the tracks towards us, and we're not going to be able to get out of the way. So we better find out. And so at one point, we had about 20 students running around with this stuff, which was just pure heaven from the television channel's point of view. We had cameramen taking pictures of us, you know, the weirdos at MIT. It was great, right? And we learned lots of things from this, and I'm going to tell you some of them today. So one of the first things we learned is that nobody in their right mind would actually dress like this. And so what I did is I went to Paris to a fashion school, and we put together a bunch of fashion and design students to ask, well, what will this stuff actually look like? What would people actually wear? And we got some very famous designers to work with us. And for a short period of time, I put on fashion shows all around the world. And I'm the only academic that has, you know, several pages in the Paris Vogue, right? I mean, it's like pretty, but I don't usually tell people that, so keep it to yourself. But this is an example of the sort of things that those fashion students came up with. So instead of the clunky stuff you saw there, they were envisioning a world where, you know, the display would be like a pair of glasses, basically, you know, and there'd be a base station, a central station that looks a lot like an iPhone 6 today. I mean, really, it was a little thing with a fingerprint reader and a screen, and that was the wireless connection. And the thing to understand about this was that the people who sponsored this work were people like Apple. Back in 1995, there's people like Samsung. So they were thinking about this a long time before the rest of us sort of figured it out. And that one of the students there, in the previous slide there, is the one that actually developed Google Glass. And Google Glass, of course, looks like this design. And the only trouble with all this stuff was that it was 20 years too early, and, you know, everybody thought it was sort of cute and interesting, but no one will ever do that. And of course, today we all run around with cell phones and stuff. But one of the things that we also learned was more or less by accident. We had 20 people who ran around for years with this stuff on, and that stuff also included sensors. So you had to know where the person was to get the wireless signal to them. Sometimes, you know, they have microphones, so you can talk to the little computer and stuff like that. And so for the very first time, we had a group of people that were wearing sensors continuously in their daily life. And what that meant is you could actually observe how people behave quantitatively and accurately for long periods of time. And you could ask things like, well, are the really productive groups behaving differently than the unproductive groups? You know, do people really have that mid-afternoon slump we all sort of feel, but do we act differently? And so on and so forth. And out of that quantitative view of things, I think a new science is emerging, and that's the thing that I call social physics. Social physics is a term that's almost two centuries old. It was invented about the time that the word physics became common, so around 1800, about the time that alchemy turned into chemistry. And there was this dream that we could really understand ourselves the way we understand physics, that we'd be able to know what sort of government really works, that we'd be able to understand how to design companies and organizations that actually work. Can you actually imagine what it would be like to have government and companies that really work? It's real. I don't think I can. I mean, it's just, you know, it's a, but you know, there is a possibility. And so that was the thing that we stumbled on that was perhaps the most important, is that there can, for the first time, be something about humans and how humans work together that really has a lot of evidence that's not just folk wisdom or, you know, a bunch of people taking surveys and stuff like that. It's really what people do, not what they say they do. Because that's what you get on surveys and that's what you get on Facebook. It's what people want you to hear, not what they actually do. So we can get what you actually, be afraid, right? Oh my God, they're gonna know what I actually do. Well, I'll talk about the be afraid part at the end here. So one of the things we discovered first is that it seems like people have two different languages. One is the one that we're conscious of, the linguistic one that we think about and we go to school for and so forth. But there's also a language of signals that we have that parallels that. And this language of signals is very old. You share it with apes and dogs and things like that. So for instance, let's look at your autonomic nervous system. So that's your fight or flight system. What happens when you get excited, when you're going to have to fight? Well, you get a lot of nervous energy. And what happens when you do that? Well, think about a three-year-old that's excited. What do? They jump around and they won't shut up, and you know, right? Huh? Or a dog. What happens when a dog's really excited? You know, the tail goes like this and yap, yap, yap. And what I'm saying here is that you can read, without really thinking about it, you can read the interest and excitement level of other people without words. You can read the interest and excitement level of other species without even thinking about it. It's that universal. And there are other ones, too, that have to do with whether people are paying attention. That has to do with the timing between people. Are there these awkward gaps or not? Or mimicry. So I don't know if you've all sort of noticed this, but you know, when you have two people talking close together and one person nods their head, you should do this if you don't know it. When one person nods their head, watch. You'll see the other person nod their head in a couple seconds. That's if they're not fighting, if they sort of understand each other, right? They just go, and it's unconscious. And what it's doing is it's telling each other that we're understanding, we're on the same page. Now, you can use these in different ways. Like, for instance, a friend of mine at Stanford built a little machine, so it's a little computer agent that would talk to people and tell them, you should always carry your Stanford ID, right, which people hated. They didn't want to do that. So it didn't work very well. And then he did something sneaky. What he did is put a little camera hidden in the back. And when the person the computer was talking to nodded their head, the little animation on the computer nodded its head too. Okay? Now, most people didn't notice this, but 30% more people agreed to carry the card. 30%! And they rated it as much more trustworthy and much more empathetic. All because the little thing was going, right, you know, when the other person did it. And that's humans. We have these old ways of communicating, these signals that we use that go along with things. And now we can observe them and we can do things with them. So, for instance, we've built little computer systems and did a bunch of experiments like the following. So we looked at people negotiating pay rises. You know, so they go in and talk to the boss. Now, these are mock negotiations, but they actually got paid for it. And they're not young people. These are like mid-career people. We could predict the pay that raise they would get to within $1,000 from their body language and their tone of voice at the beginning in the first 5 minutes. And if you pay me enough, I'll tell you how to do it. No. You could buy my book called Honest Signals, which is the earlier one, right, and find out. It's pretty straightforward. We went to a bar where people were doing speed dating. So, you know, the man and woman sit down, they talk for 3 minutes, and then they write down secretly whether or not they're going to exchange contact information, right? And it turns out we could do a really bang-up job of predicting whether or not they would write down that contact information that they were going to exchange just by listening to the signals. We didn't know anything about the people. We didn't know anything about what they said, just the signaling behavior, looking at things like mimicry and how excited they were. And of course, it was only the woman's signal that mattered. The man's signal was pretty much irrelevant to the whole process. Oh, well. Or the one that I really like is we got people who are pitching business plans. And these were real, because these guys were about to graduate, and they were sort of pitching what they were going to do after they graduated. And other people who were mid-career were sort of rating them. And we had this computer system listen to the signaling, and we could predict how the people in the audience would rate the business plan pitch about as well as people could do it, but without listening to the words. So think about that. The next time someone comes into your office or comes to your door and pitches you on something, you know, you might want to focus on the words or the written thing rather than the pitch. And an explanation of this is, you know, if somebody sounds very enthusiastic about it and they sound like they've practiced it a lot, they've thought about it a lot, then you seem to say in the back of your head somewhere that, well, you know, I don't know anything about this, but sounds like they know a lot about it, and it sounds like they're really enthusiastic, so it must be good. So be careful. Okay. So those are some of the things that we discovered by putting sensors on people's bodies. And now it's a commercial thing. One of my students went off, started a company. So I don't know if many of you have chronic health problems, but for many of the large insurers now, when the nurse talks to you about, take your medicine, right? You know, and what does everybody say when the nurse calls you up? Let's imagine you have congestive heart failure, and they call you up, and she says, you should be sure to take your pills. What do you say? You say, sure, right? And about half of you are just BSing, okay? You just want to get off the phone, go do something else. What the computer is doing is it warns her that you're just BSing, because she's so focused on the facts and what she's supposed to do on this little script that she misses the fact that you're not really paying attention, you're not engaged. And so it says, you know, this person's not really, they're just trying to get you off the phone. And Aetna, for instance, estimates that this saves them $20,000 per seat per month in being able to have the nurse connect better with the patient, to know when the patient is on the same page and when they're not. And if they're not on the same page, being able to have a different sort of conversation. So that's sort of a practical thing. We learned some other things. A more general thing has to do with the structure of our brains and the structure of our lives. So our brains have two parts, at least, but there's an older part that's the central part, and there's a newer part, which is our cortex, which is relatively unique to humans. So most of the animals in the world have only the older part. And in fact, all of our sensory things come into the older part. And what that older part seems to do is mostly our habitual behaviors, the routine in our life. And what the newer part seems to do is the novelty. And people are healthy when they have a mix of the habitual and the novelty. And in animals, we call this foraging behavior, you know, so the animal knows where to get the food, goes to the same place all the time, but if you watch them, every once in a while, they ignore the food, even though they need food, and they go explore for new places for food. And that balance between exploration and exploitation is a mark of a healthy animal. So what happens in humans when our balance between habitual behavior and exploratory behavior gets off? Well, bad things happen. So for instance, here's an illustration of it. So we had access to a lot of credit card data. This should worry you, and we'll talk about it at the end. We didn't actually have this data, but we had the ability to run queries against it, ask questions about it. It was held by a large financial institution. And if you analyze this data, what you find are things like this. These are the common places that people go, the big circles and the transitions. So, you know, you get up in the morning, you go to the gas station, then you go to the supermarket, then maybe you go get lunch someplace, and you do that almost every day. That's your habit. okay? And then every once in a while, Saturday morning, you're off after work, something like that, you break loose and you do other stuff. You explore. And that's the exploration stuff. That's all these little things that you go to just once in a while. Very unpredictable, whereas the central stuff is very predictable. So that's the way most people are. But not everybody has the same balance. So this is a little complicated, but this is how much people explore, and that is how much they change their habits. And the blue dots are people who don't have much disposable income. They're fairly poor. And when they explore, it's to find a better deal. They're being economic agents, to find a cheaper supermarket, something like that. So when they find something, they change their habits. So their exploration and their turnover are tightly related. The red dots are people with a lot of disposable income, and they just explore for the heck of it. They don't necessarily change their habits at all. And they do a lot of exploration. And what they're doing seems to be building up knowledge about the neighborhood, about their world, that they don't immediately exploit. So they're building up a store of knowledge about the environment. But what happens when this balance goes wrong? Well, it turns out that we had data from a bank, again, not in this country. It's a medium-sized country in the Middle East. And they, of course, look for people with credit cards that are going to get into trouble. And they use demographic stuff, like how old are you, how much money do you make, things like that. And they can do a halfway decent job of predicting people who are not going to be able to pay the credit card back, or going to, you know, fail to make payments at all, things like that. But if we look at that exploration and habitual balance, what we find is the people whose balance is out of whack is a much better predictor than all of the facts about how much money you make or what gender you are or how old you are. So there's this balance that we have to maintain, and when we get out of whack, our whole life falls apart. In fact, it's not just economic stuff that falls apart. And an example of this is if you become erratic in when you show up for work and when you shop for food and things like that, if you become erratic in that, or if you have almost no exploration or large swaths of exploration, rather than sort of short vignettes, those are some signs that you're going to have economic problem. So you might want to pay attention to that. But here's another thing that we were able to do, and this is a spinoff from my group. It turns out that when people are depressed or when they're getting sick, this balance between habit and exploration changes also. So what we were able to do is we gave smartphones to everybody in a small community, and we bugged them. So every morning they had to answer questions about how they felt. Were they depressed? You know, were they feeling sick? You know, were their nose running? Things like that. And what we found is that this type of behavior was able to detect when people were getting sick or depressed with about 80% accuracy across the whole population, knowing nothing about the people. Zero, right? It's just they weren't behaving normally, right? And not normally for them. They weren't behaving like everybody else, and that was an indicator that they were in stress. They were getting sick of some way. Now, that got turned into a company, and the chief technical officer of the United States learned about this and said, this is an innovation that will save our health system. Now, what's that about? Well, here's what it's about. Kaiser Permanente, who's the major investor in this, has millions and millions of people that they provide health care to. And at any one day, many thousands of these people are getting sick. But Kaiser Permanente has no idea which ones, because they haven't come in to see a doctor or come into the emergency room, right? They're just sitting at home getting sicker and sicker. And finally, when they do come in, they're going to be quite sick. And it's going to be hard to fix them, and it's going to be very expensive. So what they're doing now is with people who are at risk, you know, with things like congestive heart failure and so forth, is they recommend that you install this on their phone. And it's like a check engine light, right? It lets them reach out to people who look like they're you know, you look like you're behaving a little like you're maybe getting sick. How are you doing? That's the question that they're able to ask. And as a consequence, they get to people before they get really sick. And that's the thing that will change the healthcare system. Okay. Interesting thing. So I've shown you things about particular people. This is a lot of people. These are people, these are actually phones roaming around in San Francisco, and the big dots are the most popular bars and restaurants. Looks like, you know, a happening city. Everybody's going everywhere. But if you look at where people go, and you cluster them by who goes to the same places, these are not people who know each other, just people who make the same choices about how to spend their time. You find that there are subpopulations in San Francisco that barely know each other. You know, there's the young and trendy guys that they do these sorts of restaurants and these sorts of, you know, entertainment. And then the people like me who do something completely different because I'm not young and trendy. And then so on and so forth. And although these people don't know each other, they're part of the same tribe, you might say. And they learn from each other because they see each other in the restaurant and the, you know, the places like this. And you learn how to dress correctly so that you fit in, right? So that people talk to you and so forth. And so what you see is these different tribes that don't mix develop different habits, different norms. And some of those norms are simple things, like, you know, one group there, the women will tend to wear a lot more red dresses than black dresses. Another group, it's the other way around. No particular reason, it's just the fad, right? But one group here doesn't pay back its credit cards very well. Well, that's a little bit of a problem. Even more of a problem is there's another group here that has 5 times the rate of diabetes of the other groups. And it's not because of their genes or any specific thing they do. It's the pattern of life that they share with other people in their tribe. So you can't point to any one thing, right? And there's another group here that has almost an order of magnitude, times 10, more likelihood of alcoholism. Now, we can say what they do, right, to get in trouble. But it's interesting to know where you can go if you want to have a health intervention. And you can't see this from the demographics. These are not things that have to do with how old you are or your gender or how much money you make. They have to do with social learning, with fitting in with the crowd, the people you run with. They used to say, you know, your parents will tell you, don't run with a bad crowd. Well, yes, that's actually true. If you run with a bad crowd, you will adopt those habits, almost certainly, whether you know it or not, and you will share the same outcomes as them. Pretty interesting. So there we are. No credit, red dresses, diabetes. Also, note that this is not data that is personal data. It's not about any one person. You can actually do this without having any information about particular people to do the segmentation. You can just have things like cell tower activity and figure out the parts of the city at what time are these different crowds doing. Then, of course, you have to talk to the people themselves to figure out their individual properties. So this notion of social learning is really important. So what the data suggest is that we learn primarily from each other. We learn the habits that we have primarily from each other. Remember I said there's novelty and habits? So we read the newspaper, we look at the internet, we learn a lot of facts. And we keep them like sort of, you know, a junk drawer in our heads. But we don't make use of most of them. When do they turn into habits? The answer seems to be, from the experiments that we've done, they turn into habits when people who are like you, that you interact with face to face, are also thinking about the same thing. So you can read about this new wonder food, you know, oh, wonderful, it's another of the 740 new wonder foods, right? You probably won't do anything about it. You might, but rarely. On the other hand, if your best friend and the person across the street and the person at the checkout counter all have it or are talking about it, you'll almost certainly begin to think seriously about trying it. It'll be something that you begin to enter into your bunch of habits that you have. And what that means is that you can look at the pattern of interactions within a city and look at how many different people you interact with, what tribes you interact with, how far you go to interact, and you can see how new habits develop and spread throughout the city. And in fact, I know the Santa Fe Institute, and Luis, among others, have been really at the fore of this, but we've done a little bit too, where you can look at these patterns of communication, face-to-face communication, and predict things like how much GDP does the city have. One of my former students, Nathan Eagle, whose parents are here, I want to embarrass you. Okay, there, okay, right? Did something else which is really interesting. He looked at the pattern of communications in England and found that you could predict all of the poverty indices. So you could actually look at the pattern of communication and predict how many babies died in that neighborhood. Isn't that interesting? You could look at the pattern of communication and predict the crime rate. Communities that are like ghettos, that don't have much of this sort of interaction within themselves and with the rest of society, don't fare very well. And since then, other researchers have picked this theme up, and we've found that in countries like the Côte d'Ivoire in Africa, like Senegal in Africa, like several other things in Europe, you can actually identify poverty hotspots and places of need by looking at these patterns of mobility or communication. And that's pretty interesting. So let me give you a concrete example of that. So this is something that we did in London. I talked O2 is owned by Telefonica, and I'm on the advisory board, into releasing their data for London around New Year's. So December, January, February, along with crime statistics, mini energy use, things like that. We looked particularly, my guys looked particularly at crime, and what we found is we could do a really bang-up job of predicting places that were going to have crime waves by these same sorts of things. And what it was doing is it was looking for places where there were different mixings between these so-called tribes, right? So, I mean, just to give you a sense, if there was a city square that used to have a lot of elders going to it, and suddenly the elders stopped going there, that was a place that was likely to have a crime wave happening. Now, we don't know why, and we certainly don't know anything about any particular person, but what we're doing is we're using the people as a sensor. We're saying, if the pattern of the society, if the social fabric is changing that rapidly, then there's stress in that society. And so one of the good explanations for why that might happen is crime. And so you should take a look at places that are undergoing that high level of stress. Right? So this is very different than what you've heard about crime prediction before, where, oh, you know, your brother was involved in crime, and therefore maybe you are too, right? There's nothing about any particular people. This is about patterns of communication within a city. It has nothing to do with individual people. And when those patterns change in ways that, particularly in ways that decrease the mixing between different types of people, that's the signal that there's likely to be higher crime rates. Obviously, sort of a useful and interesting thing. So a lot of what I've just said here is very anti the way we usually think of ourselves. So we're taught by economists and people like that to think of ourselves as individuals, rational individuals, making, you know, decisions. And what I've just said is that the social ties are the things that make us smarter or dumber. They're the way we learn from each other, and they're a very important part of what we end up doing. But let's say we wanted to change things. How would we do it? Well, if we think of ourselves as individuals, then we would give rewards to individuals, right? If I'm going to change your behavior, I will give you some money if you change your behavior, right? Or if I'm of a sort of legal bent, I'll penalize you if you don't do it, right? You have to pay a fine. But what I've just told you is that perhaps the biggest effect is the social effect. It's learning from other people. So another thing you can do that's very different is have a social incentive rather than a individual incentive. You can change the social fabric rather than the individual. Change what ties us together as opposed to our conscious mind. And I will point out that our conscious mind has precious little to do with our habits, okay? Which is why it doesn't work very often. If you do the math for this, it looks like a lot of sort of standard economics math. It's a game theoretic solution on a network. It's pretty interesting. You Santa Fe guys might be interested, some of you. But let me give you an example to make this concrete. So I took a community and gave everybody smartphones because I had to buy them off. This comes under medical research, so everybody knows it and everybody signs off and everybody, you know, can drop out anytime they want. But if they drop out, they have to give me back the phone. Okay, so it's a little deal. Anyway, so I gave everybody in a small community a smartphone with a pedometer on it. And for half the community, I did the following. I said, well, okay, if you're more active than you were last week, then you make some money. And they could look at their phone and see how active they were, how many steps they took and stuff like that. And if they were better than last week, they could see how much money they were making. Pretty good, right? Particularly in Boston, where it gets pretty gray and drizzly in the fall, which is when we did this. But for the other half of the community, we did something different. For everybody in that part of the community, we signed them up with some buddies. The buddies were the people that they were closest to, non-family members, though. And if you improved your activity level this week, your buddies could see it on their smartphone, they could see your pedometer, and they got money for it. Okay? And you were okay with it because you were somebody else's buddy, and if they improved, then you would get money, right? Now, it may sound a little weird, but we had almost every single person sign up for it. They had to think about it a little bit, but almost everybody signed up. What was interesting is that the buddy system was almost 8 times more effective than the individual system. And after we ran out of money, and we're a university, so we don't have all that much money, it stuck. The buddy system stuck. Whereas the individual things, people said, oh, I'm not making any money. I'm just going to sit on the couch, put a blanket over my head, and you'll see me in March, right? So it was something that was really different. You can do this at scale. We took a canton in Switzerland. It's like a state that was having trouble with electricity. They're mostly hydroelectric. And when they get above what they can do with hydroelectric, they use diesel, which is very dirty, particularly in these high mountain areas, and very expensive. And they tried everything to keep out of the diesel area, you know, give people financial rewards, educate them. Nothing was working. And so we talked them into trying out the buddy system. So we said, have people sign up with some buddies, and if you save energy, your buddy gets a reward. And the rewards were it's Switzerland, I don't know, you know, so there's little dancing bears that are worth about 10 cents. It's like the state animal, right? So it's actually a marmot, I think. Anyway, so on a budget of about 50 cents a week per person, we were able to get them to save 17% of the energy. That's a lot. Now, let me give you how big that is. If you tried to do that with straight economical rewards, there have been some places where this has happened, you have to double the price of energy to get 17% reduction. And we did it with five little dancing bears per person. So it's interesting to think about. Since then, we've been doing this in companies where we're helping people lower their stress level, doing it in public health where we're helping people not get into trouble in various ways, and so on and so forth. So that's thinking about the social fabric rather than the individuals. Now, if you put all this together, you can do some interesting things. Working with the company Orange, which is a large telco in Europe and in Africa, we got them to release this sort of data in an aggregate safe form, so no individual data, for the country of Côte d'Ivoire, which is a Western African country that had a civil war not very long ago. And we also got, I got the UN and the World Economic Forum, a couple others, to sort of contribute lots of data that they had also. Now, Côte d'Ivoire, like many of the African countries, hasn't had a census for more than 30 years. And since they had a civil war, you couldn't send the census guys in half of the country because they'd get shot, right? It's like, you know, okay, so how are you going to run the country? Well, what we did is we collected this data together, or actually Orange did. It was all a donation from them. And we opened this up to the world, and we had academic groups from all over the world say what they thought they could do and then actually try to do it. And we had one group that changed their map of their public transportation system. So no additional money, just changing where the buses go, and was able to save 10% of the fuel and 10% of the commute time. That's huge, right? We had another group that was able to improve their public health system with respect to infectious diseases, read SARS, Ebola, things like that, by more than 20%. Now, they didn't have a chance to test it, thank God, but now they knew how what the paths of infection were through looking at the patterns of how people moved. And then we had another group that was able to do things like map pockets of poverty that the government never knew about. Again, sort of a good thing. So you get the idea that in the large chunk of the world that doesn't have it nearly as good as you and I do, where there are no government systems to help the poor or prevent violence or so on and so forth, that this big data might have a really important role in raising the standard of living. And in fact, this fall, I worked on a committee for the UN Secretary General preparing this report, which I would recommend that you read. It's very interesting, short also, don't worry. It's not like technical or anything either. But it makes it very clear that the development goals of all the countries in the world, all the countries that are member of the UN, have to include these sorts of techniques because they're failing to be able to measure things like infant mortality. They don't have the people, they don't have the money, there's too much other things going on, people with AK-47s, stuff like that. Using these sort of techniques, you can begin to look at things like ethnic violence, infant mortality, look at inequalities of various sorts, genocides. For the very first time, you can see these things pretty much in real time. It's not expensive to do, but it requires harvesting these sorts of new sorts of data in an ethical way and a safe way. And that's what the report says, is if we are going to have an ethical, if we're going to have a world that actually addresses these fundamental issues of poverty and of inequality and of violence, we need this, and we need to do it in an open and ethical way. So do take a look at it. To be able to develop these things is, however, not completely simple. We had a paper recently in Science, this famous journal, showing that, for instance, anonymizing data, like you take off all the names, like people do, and now you can use the data for things, doesn't work. In fact, it generically doesn't work. That means that almost always, except for some special cases, the current practices with this data are broken. With just four other pieces of data about someone's behavior, you can re-identify everything about them. And that's almost always true. So what are you going to do? Well, what you're going to do is you're going to get a bunch of smart people together who know about this stuff, and you're going to try out new things, new ways to think about this. And then you're going to test it, and you're going to get it written into law and stuff like that. And so 6 years ago, I started a group at the World Economic Forum in Davos that consisted of, you know, people like the chairman of Vodafone, which is the world's largest telco, and, you know, the head of Microsoft, and the chief regulator for the Federal Trade Commission, the justice commissioner for the EU, people like that, and talked about this. And the, I think, very positive result of this discussion, which was several years long, was that the real problem is that people, you, don't have control over your digital identity, over your digital body. You know, we have rights over our physical body, and you have a digital identity. There's all this data about you out there, but you don't own any of it. You don't even know what it is, right? Companies own it, the government owns it. You, me, we're clueless. And as long as you live in that sort of situation, it's a little bit like slavery or serfdom. You know, we don't control our digital identity. That has to change. People have to know what's happening. People have to give their permission to things. And if they discover after giving their permission that they don't like it, they have to be able to take it back. That means all those terms and conditions that you always have to click on, or all those, you know, EULAs, they're called, the legal agreements, those all go away. So, great. We're going to control our digital identity. We're going to have, you know, digital democracy. So what is actually happening? Well, what's actually happening in this country is the Federal Trade Commission has adopted that stance as something they're beginning to enforce. We have the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights before Congress. You never know. Might actually pass, right? Maybe the only piece of legislation. but you should encourage them to vote for it, right? And in Europe, they're called the Data Protection Acts, and those are being passed. And the fact that they're done in Europe is going to force them to be done by all the companies here, because they operate in Europe too. So we may get it sort of despite ourselves. But that gives us much more control over our digital identity, and hopefully we can move towards this sort of digital democracy. In the meantime, what people like myself are doing is checking it out. So, is this a good thing or not? What happens when people are in control of it? What happens when there's this sort of data more available? What are the bugs? What are the dangers? You can probably think up lots of things that are scary. So what I decided to do with some friends is try it out. So there's a little part of Italy that's actually not part of Italy. It was never conquered. It's called Trentino. It's in the northeast. It's sort of cool. It's like Italy in everything except it doesn't share the deficit with Italy and it doesn't share the taxes with Italy. Right? It's like, hey, pretty good. And what they've done is they've set up a regime where people have more control over their data. And so the telcos are part of this and the municipal government and the big stores. And so you can see what people are collecting about you, and you can opt into it. And what's interesting is that from my lab, we've produced software that they use that changes the risk reward for sharing. So people that are part of this living lab can share very personal stuff with confidence that it doesn't go any further. So example, what's personal stuff? Well, you take young families. Young families are sharing credit card data, but they share it. So they say, well, do you spend as much on childcare as I do? Do you spend as much on gasoline as I do? Things like that. You know, it's pretty important. And Nobody talks about money, right? So they're beginning to share it because they can say, I'll share it in a way that's not identifiable, and I know that my insurance company will never see it, right? They're doing things like the following. They're putting out the location of their children on Saturday. Now, how many of you would post the location of your children or your grandchildren on the internet? If you raise your hand, you should go home and spank yourself or something. Don't do it. But they can do it because they can be confident it only goes to people that they have a close relationship with, and it goes nowhere else. And so what that means is their friends are going to see that, you know, you get a little notice that says, six of your friends are going to have their kids at the museum Saturday morning. And what do you do? Well, God, I'm going to go to the museum, right? Get to talk to my friends. And so they love it. That's what happens a very personal way when you begin sharing data. So I'm going to end there because otherwise it sounds like something's going to blow up. Right? And I'll pump for my book a little bit. It's $12 on Amazon. And it talks about a lot of this stuff. So thank you. So I guess we have time for a couple questions. Is that right or no? I don't know what your tradition is here. No, you're going to. So yeah, I've done this before. I know, right? Oh, so the question is that we use the buddy system in education. And the answer is, in this country, it's very difficult to do experiments with kids, because the laws around that are really very strict. We have done some in Europe where we've looked at the relationship between people who are best buddies and learning, and found that, yeah, indeed, having buddies really helps in some cases. And we'd love to do more, and I think some people are beginning to do it. It, you know, to do that as a research thing requires having a group that spends full time getting the federal approvals and getting the buy-in of the teachers and getting the buy-in of the parents and so forth. So we're looking forward to working with people like that. But I can do all the data for a whole country, but I can't get into a school. Okay, that's the bottom line on that, right? Okay. Sir. Ah, so Facebook.
Other, you know, other places like that. And if we start to say we don't want Facebook anymore, then those kind of companies disappear.
Yes. So the strategy for the regulators is this. You have to understand the way the law works in this country. They usually can only pass laws when they can demonstrate a harm. So how has Facebook hurt you? Well, we can all sort of have this unease about it, but it's sort of hard to point at a specific thing, okay? So that's one side of it. But there's a bunch of companies that would like to offer similar services, telcos, banks, health services, things where you can do data sharing. And some of these would really be good for us, and some of it would be just more spam, okay? And so the regulators look at this and say, well, you know what? Those companies are heavily regulated. They have to get permission to do it. Facebook grew up, you know, in the sort of wild west of the internet. These regulated companies, if they want to get into it, they have to obey the rules. So let's imagine that these regulated companies are more respectful of individuals and give people control over their data, which essentially means you're not going to opt into anything unless it really means something to you, right? They have to give you something you care about before you say yes, and they have to guarantee that it's safe. Okay? Those are the risk and reward, right? Well, if you get other companies that are regulated companies doing it the right way, Then the regulators can go to the Facebooks of the world and say, yeah, excuse me, see those guys over there, the regulated ones? They're doing it just fine. So don't give me this stuff about innovation and stifling innovation. You have to do it too. But they're not going to be able to do that or drive them out of business until they get the regulated industries doing it. What they are doing is you'll notice that there's a lot more lawsuits by the Federal Trade Commission. Anybody who's sharing data without fairly explicit notification is getting inquiries and getting asked about what they're doing, and the pressure will go up and up over time. It will take years.
What do you think of that idea? I think Jaron Lanier suggested that we should be paid.
I think it's a stupid idea. Absolutely stupid. I don't want to be paid $30 a month. Like AT&T, I have friends at AT&T, I help them. They had a thing recently where they'd cut your bill by $30 if you let them use their data, and everybody told them to go shove it, right? I mean, $30, you know, it's just not that much money, and God knows what they're doing with it. Don't do it, okay? On the other hand, you know, if you can get really personalized medicine, yeah, sign me up, okay? If you can make the school that my kids go to work better because there are no bullies or whatever, sign me up, okay? Those are things I care about, right? Those are worth maybe not any amount of money, but pretty much any amount of money, right? And so I think that that's what we need to demand, is a better deal. In fact, what I call this is the New Deal on data, right? So I don't want to get people to get bought off, right? And in fact, in Italy, this little town, people don't like paying, you know, we have tried the money also. People are, you know, will do a little bit of it, but they're really not very happy about it, as I think they shouldn't be. So I really hope things don't go that way. Uh-oh.
Okay, so he's watching on YouTube right now. But Miguel Wood asks, do you expect social physics to reinvigorate democracy in the age of a network society?
Okay, so do I expect social physics to reinvigorate democracy in this digital age? I would hope so. So let me tell you the way that at least I see it today. I don't have all the answers. We just like work on things, right? What I see is that social media, like Twitter, for instance, have made the population much more involved with politics, with the news, instantly. But remember that facts don't change habits, right? It's face-to-face stuff. It's your friends, it's your buddies, it's your peers that change habits. So it's like we're cascaded with all this stuff that is fundamentally like our junk drawer. Our junk drawer is really, really full. And that makes, you know, careful consideration of things more difficult because there's all this stuff to think about and talk about, and it's hard to focus on the important stuff. One of the ways you see that is when a story happens, it's interesting. It gets copied everywhere. It's not a new story that's getting copied. It's the same story. So we think, oh gosh, everybody's talking about X. Well, no, it's just a bunch of bloggers copying the original guy without attribution. So there's this sort of like herding. Everyone's rushing this way and rushing, you know. It makes it very hard to do things. It makes the political process, the deliberative process, very, very difficult. So there's a bunch of things you could do. One thing you could do is you could have a little filter on your Twitter account or your Facebook account or whatever that got rid of all the copies, right? And you could not have so much junk in your junk drawer. That would be useful. Another thing, though, and this is controversial, but I'll tell you, this sort of voting thing that we have is based, the current structure of voting is based on the science of the late 1700s, right? That we're all individuals, rational individuals, right? Well, I'm not all that rational, and I'm certainly not an individual, because what I care about has a lot to do with all the people around me. What I know and want has to do with the people around me. We're not individuals, we're part of a social fabric. It's well known and well demonstrated that when you try to make decisions where there's influences between people, voting is a bad way to do it. It leads to fads, it leads to bubbles, it leads to all sorts of bad things, which may be why the U.S. was set up as a representative government rather than a pure democracy. But there may be a better way to do it. I actually think the way the United States was set up worked really pretty well back when there was a thin population and travel was hard and there were no sort of, you know, bombardment with lots of sort of stuff. It obviously wasn't perfect, but it wasn't too bad. But as you get much denser population and much faster information, you get this thing that's sort of unstable and spinning out of control. And I think that's the sort of problem. So what I would hope is that by understanding people and the social fabric and how we make decisions as a group, we can improve our system. I don't know how. Okay? Yep.
Sounds a good deal like what we're dealing with here.
That's true. I think that the way... Okay, so the question is, E.O. Wilson wrote a book recently called The Conquest of the Earth?
Social
Concepts of the Earth, which is about how essentially social networks allowed humans to take over the Earth. And I think he's basically correct. I mean, I could pick nits and stuff, but... You know, what I see in the data that we have is that people are set up to adopt new behaviors and become more competitive to thrive by doing the following. They're sort of like bees. We go out during the day, we find new ideas, we bring them back with our peers, we bounce them off of each other, and if we all like it, we begin doing it. So, you know, originally this is around campfires and stuff, and the issues were things like, well, do we migrate to the east or do we migrate to the west? You know, where's the food? But you see the same thing in companies today. There's, you know, engagement with your work group or engagement with your peer group in a community. And then there's this sort of searching for ideas, which incidentally is a place where the internet and so forth is good. But it's this conversation with people, and typically face-to-face conversation is required, that lets us adopt behaviors that are compatible among the population. And I think that's who we are. And it's an interesting view because it does not reinforce the idea that there are geniuses in the world or in the human race, that it's really a collective intelligence that we have that comes from working together to find the best solutions with very specific mechanisms. And I didn't talk about it, but we've done a lot of research in this area, and it's interesting that you can actually watch groups, independent of what they're doing, and tell how good a solution they'll do just by watching the pattern of interaction. So, buy the book, read the paper in Science, whatever you want. But you know, it's not so much about strategy and logic and our big brains. It's about how we put our brains together. And that's the thing that makes groups work well. So good. I guess that's time. So thank you all very much for coming.